Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to be exploring the backwards different method theory. In this video, we'll explore the fundamentals of numerical differentiation, how to derive the backwards different method, and talk about why we need to learn about this numerical differentiation method. Before we get into the theory of the backwards difference method, let's quickly recap what numerical differentiation is. In numerical methods, differentiation involves approximating the derivative of a function at some point using numerical techniques rather than exact mathematical formulas. Through approximations, we simplify a ton, and we can get very close to our actual answer with significantly less work. The backwards different method is one such technique that allows us to estimate the derivative of a function at a given point using numerical methods. The reason we are going to learn about the backwards difference method and other finite difference methods are that they become extremely useful in the future, as we can turn complicated ordinary differential equations and partial differential equations into algebraic equations that are much easier to solve, especially when using a computer. But that is a problem for a future video. The backwards difference method is particularly useful if we have some previous data points and no future ones. To understand backwards difference method, let's begin by remembering the definition of a derivative. If we begin with a secant line, that is the line passing through two points on a function, the difference in y, denoted here by delta y, over our difference in x, denoted by delta x, is going to be our slope between these two points. As we learned in calculus, as our delta x term gets smaller and smaller, our secant line begins to approximate the tangent line at the input of xi, which is the derivative as the limit goes to zero. This line then becomes the instantaneous rate of change at point x. Well, how does that help us understand numerical differentiation? Well, if we are okay with good approximations of what this derivative is, and not exactly, as we would in, say, an analytical sense, we can say that the derivative at point x is roughly the change in our function across a very small change in x. Thereby, assuming a finite small change in x, we can make our lives much easier and solve much more complicated problems by just giving up a bit of accuracy. So how does this work and how does it relate to the backwards difference method? Well, we want an understanding of how much accuracy we need to give up in order to get a good approximation of our derivative. Well, how do we go about finding that? We do this through the use of Taylor series approximations. If you recall or have not learned in the past, Taylor series represents a function as an infinite sum of terms. And what it does is it provides an approximation of a given function within a certain interval around a center point that we give it of the series. The series itself does not necessarily give the entire function, but rather it gives an extremely good local approximation of the function around the center point using the derivatives at that point. Therefore, the Taylor series approximation does not always give us a function with a domain from negative infinity to positive infinity. To illustrate this, let's look at the Taylor series for the function e to the x centered at 1. Looking at our formula here, our x is a small future x value that we are going to be finding. A is our center point, and n is our term's power, which will make more sense here shortly. Now, let's say that we want to find up to our second order Taylor series approximation. Firstly, we begin at n equals 0. Then, we will go back through and simplify after. Then, we will move to our higher power terms. Then, from here, you could continue to add terms, hence the definition of Taylor series as an infinite sum. But, we will cut it off here, and we could say that our next term would be of order to the third power. But, we'll talk about that shortly. Simplifying our Taylor series, we get the following equation. Let's plot our actual e to the x function, and then the first and second order Taylor series approximations at a center point of 1. The first order expansion will just be the first two terms here, and this is simply a straight line. Secondly, our second order expansion is an even better approximation as it uses a parabola. If you were to continue, a third order would give you a cubic. As you can see, within a small range around our center point, we have a very good approximation of our function. However, when we deviate too far from our center point, our approximation becomes worse and worse. This is because we are truncating or cutting off additional fitting terms in our Taylor series expansion. With each additional term, our approximation gets better and better as we have less error. But we'll come back to this concept shortly. Now that we have reviewed Taylor series approximations, how does this help us understand the error of our backwards difference method? Well, let's begin by writing out a couple terms of the Taylor series expansion for some previous x point slightly behind our current data point. This is our step size, how big of a step our secant line is traveling between points. Remember, the closer that these points are, the better our approximation. Here I'm using xi to denote the center point of our Taylor series expansion, and xi minus 1 as our backwards data point that is some finite distance away. Since we have a negative step size here, we could substitute the following equation, and this alters our functions from positive to negative, depending on if we have an odd or even term in the Taylor series expansion. After we do some rearranging of terms, we get the following equation, which, if we look in this region here, looks a lot like the definition of a derivative from earlier, especially for smaller changes in x. Therefore, we can approximate the first derivative by chopping off or truncating our higher order terms. And this is often valid when our h term here is very small but finite. We saw this in the earlier e to the x example. Locally, our first order approximation was very good. And this is our backwards difference method, as we are looking forward at our Taylor series center point and we are using a finite difference over some discrete value. In terms of the error, the larger the difference in our step term, the more error our linear approximation of the derivative will give us as we truncated all of our higher order fitting terms. Therefore, with the backwards difference method, we say that it has an error proportional to h, much like the forwards difference method. All subsequent or higher order terms are going to have less and less of an influence on our error term, as you can see here. Therefore, our error term can be stated like so. I hope that this video helped your understanding of what the backwards difference method is and how we go about implementing it. In the next video, we will explore an example of how to use the backwards difference method, so if you're at all still confused on this method, that video should help clarify things. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our YouTube memberships by clicking that join button down below. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below and I will do my best to address your concerns.